Hey guys, Jake from 8020 Media here. Today we're going to be talking about common problems and engine power limits of the 4G63 and 4G63T turbocharged engines. The 4G63T was used in the first 9 generations of the Lancer Evo and was also used in popularly modified DSM vehicles like the Eagle Talon and the Mitsubishi Eclipse. Both the 4G63 and the 4G63T are extremely reliable engines when left in stock form. However, since these are used on cars like the Evo and other highly modified vehicles, there are some considerations to think about once we start adding power to these engines, as there are some unique problems that start to arise once we add power to them. So for this video, we're mostly going to be talking about the 4G63T and talking about problems that arise once you start to modify them, just since in completely stock form, you're not going to run into too many of these issues. And additionally, the 4G63 engine itself isn't as popularly modified as the 4G63T. So a lot of these problems are going to be specific to the turbocharged version of this engine. Once we get to the end of this video, I'm going to go ahead and spend a little bit of time talking about the safe, reliable power limits of the 4G63T engines so that you know what potential problems you're going to run into if you look to heavily modify these and start taking them into the 400-500 plus wheel horsepower range. So with the first problem, we have balance shaft bearings and the balance shaft belt. The 4G63T uses a belt-driven dual balance shaft design. What it's designed to do is reduce engine vibrations. However, the bearings within the balance shaft design are prone to wearing down and wearing out over time. And what that does is cause improper rotation of the balance shafts, which actually leads to more engine vibration. When a bearing fails, it typically then causes the balance shaft belt to fail. And that creates a snowball effect, which then leads to the timing belt failing as well. When all these problems occur and it results in a snapped timing belt, you typically are gonna run into some pretty serious engine damage. In a worst case scenario, the valves will collide with the pistons and crack the pistons, which will then score the inside of the cylinder walls. And ultimately, you're gonna be looking at needing a completely new or rebuilt engine. And in the best case of scenarios, you end up bending your rods, which again is not a cheap or easy to fix problem. Ultimately, the balance shaft bearing problem is probably the most important problem to be aware of just because it can lead to some pretty serious engine damage. Now, since the issue is predominantly caused by the bearings, the most surefire way of fixing this problem is by doing a balance shaft delete. You can upgrade the balance shaft belt to a heavier Kevlar belt, which will help improve the reliability of the belt itself. However, when the bearings go bad and the balance shaft starts to wobble, it's probably gonna snap the Kevlar belt as well, and it's gonna snap with more force, and still then is gonna lead to the timing belt snapping as well and all of these problems. So if you're looking at doing a high horsepower build and you're rebuilding a motor or getting a built motor, it's common to go ahead and do a balance shaft delete, since once you start adding serious power to these and start pushing them into the 450, 500 plus wheel horsepower range, you're gonna significantly increase the likelihood of running into issues with these balance shafts. The second problem with the 4G63T is lifter tick and failed lifters. The 4G63 has a naturally poor oiling system, and so the oil pressure in the heads is a little bit low, and what that ends up causing is oil starvation to the lifters, which creates the dreaded lifter tick on these engines. A common upgrade is running 3G lifters, but because this problem isn't with the lifters themselves, it's with the oiling of the heads. Even the 3G lifters, while they are more reliable, stronger, and more capable, the 3G lifters are ultimately going to end up developing lifter tick and fail eventually as well. So the only way to fix the oiling problem in the 4G63 is to port out the oil galleys in the head to improve oil pressure and oil flow to the lifters. Now, this of course requires some machine work. It's not something that I would recommend doing if you aren't currently rebuilding or building your motor. A lot of people in this instance tend to just drive with the lifter tick and ignore it. But if you do end up getting a built motor or rebuilding your motor, then it's worthwhile to look into fixing the oiling issues within the head. The third problem on the list is crank walk. The 4G63 and 4G63T engines came in two different versions. One was a 6-bolt design, and then the other is a 7-bolt design. The 6-bolt design was only used from 1990 to like 1992 and a half, and was only used in the first gen DSM engines. So all of the Evos and later the 92 DSMs are gonna have the 7-bolt version, and crank walk is something that you have to be aware of for the 7-bolt versions. The 6-bolts are a little bit stronger than the 7-bolts, and that's because the 7-bolts have a narrower journey because of using that additional bolt on there. So what tends to happen, and this really only happens once you start adding a lot of power to these engines, is that the bearings on the crankshaft tend to wear down. And what happens is that allows the crankshaft to wiggle or move a little bit, which is this phenomenon that's called crank walk. Of course, the crankshaft moving and wobbling around is not good, as that will end up throwing engine timing off and can lead to a number of other serious problems like cracking your crankshafts. Fortunately, the crank walk problem only affects a relatively small number of 7-bolt engines. It's estimated at about 5% of the 7-bolt engines experience crank walk, but that is in stock form. And if you heavily modify these, you're gonna significantly increase the chance of experiencing crank walk. Crank walk becomes a lot more likely in engines that are running upgraded clutches and have high pedal pressures. Moving on to the fourth problem with the 4G63 is going to be lifting heads and head gasket failure. The head bolts on the 4G63T are extremely short, and they don't even go down into the deck more than half an inch, and so the heads just are not very well secured to the decks and to the blocks on these engines, which means that once we start adding power to them, getting higher engine temperatures, it's possible for those bolts to warp and for the heads to start lifting. Ultimately, the heads lifting becomes a lot more likely of a problem once you start talking about 300 plus wheel horsepower. So if you are looking at pushing past that 300 wheel horsepower level, which isn't too far away from what some of these engines produce in stock form, you will want to look into getting ARP head studs to better secure the head. Now, once you start talking about pushing past 500 wheel horsepower, that's when you'll need to do a couple further things to secure the head. One popular route is getting oversized washers. However, oversized washers require you to machine the head, and so most people, unless they're rebuilding the head or rebuilding their engine, just opt for putting ARP head studs on there, which are going to be safe up to about the 500 wheel horsepower limit before you're going to need to start looking at securing the head in other ways. And part of the issues with the head here come down to the oiling issues that we talked about before. This can lead to higher temperatures within the head, which is what helps create some of those bolts warp and the heads to lift. So those are the four problems to talk about on the 4G63T engines. The balance shaft failure is something that can happen in stock form, as is the lifter tick because of the design of the heads and the oil galleys within them. But crank walk and lifting the heads are really two problems that only occur once we start talking about heavily modifying these engines. So with that being said, let's go ahead and talk a little bit about the power limits of the 4G63T. Like I mentioned earlier, the 6-bolt engines are stronger and are not prone to the crank walk problems that the 7-bolt engines have. And so the 6-bolt engines can actually handle up to about 600 wheel horsepower. At 600 wheel horsepower, we might not be talking about a ton of reliability, but they can get up to those limits in completely stock form. However, the 6-bolt, like I mentioned, was only used from 1990 until 1992 and some change. And so if you're looking at modifying your Evo or any DSM that's a Gen 2 or a later Gen 1 onwards, you're gonna have a 7-bolt engine. Now, the DSMs did not come with fully forged internals like the Evos did, so the Evos are a little bit more power capable in stock form than some of those DSMs that didn't receive forged rods and forged pistons. So talking about Evo power limits here, the first thing that you're gonna wanna do is get ARP head studs. As I mentioned, anything over 300 wheel horsepower, that's when you're gonna start needing these. You certainly aren't gonna wanna try to push past 325 or 350 wheel horsepower without them, but with just a good set of ARP head studs, we can get to about 500 wheel horsepower before we need to start talking about other considerations. The blocks on these engines are extremely strong. They can easily push 600 wheel horsepower plus in stock form, and fully built, they can push 1200 plus wheel horsepower. You can take a stock block more than 600 or 700 wheel horsepower. However, to get to those levels, you're gonna need to do some pretty serious internal modifications. And so at that point, it probably makes sense to go ahead and upgrade your block as well to be able to handle 1000 plus wheel horsepower. So ultimately you can push the stock block to some pretty high power levels, but at that point it probably makes sense to upgrade the block as well, since you're gonna be doing a lot of other serious modifications to this engine at that point. With respect to the internals, the rods and the pistons, about 500 wheel horsepower is also gonna be the relatively safe limit there. So when we look at the 4G63T engine in general, with forged internals like the ones that came in the Evo vehicles, 450 to 500 wheel horsepower is the approximate safe limit on a completely stock engine with ARP head studs. 500 wheel horsepower is probably pushing the boundaries of reliability, and 450 wheel horsepower is gonna be what I would call the completely safe, kind of reliable limit for these engines. As we talk about reliability and power limits, so much of this comes down to tuning and having proper tuning. Wheel horsepower is typically not the killer to these engines, it's torque, and so making sure you have proper tuning. So working with a tuner that understands the torque limits and the power band limitations of this engine is extremely important to making sure that you have a reliable high horsepower power build. And then of course, to take things beyond 500 wheel horsepower, we have to start talking about a lot of internal modifications and more advanced mods. And so that's something that we might save for a performance upgrade specific video on the 4G63T. So that wraps up our video for today. If you guys appreciate this content, please click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and stay tuned for the future content that we have coming on the 4G63T.